The floor is yours. Very welcome to Riga, Anna.
Thank you so much. Yeah, the floor is not mine, but ours. And during the talk, I will introduce like concept that I would like to share with you. But at the same time, I would like your participation, and there will be several questions that I would like to think about and to answer. And there will be a practical thing, so how we can apply or how we can think of what we have discussed. In that case, so don't expect it that you will be just sitting and listening. No way. It will be boring for me as well, so let's see. We will be talking about leadership and specifically about agile leadership in the case that it is so-called powerless leadership. When we don't have some like specific managerial power that we can give orders and people according to our organizational design will be able, should obey and should do what we told them to do. In this case, no. We don't have this type of power in organization, especially Scrum Masters. But how we can manage the team? Or how we can help team to be self-managed? That is even more difficult. And so we need to have power that is applied to a powerless, initially powerless leader. Where this power comes from? That's me. I'm Anna Obukhova. I'm from St. Petersburg, Russia, and I'm Scrum Master from 2005, coming from Scrum Master, then Project Program Portfolio Manager. But initially, I'm a biologist, so my first career is in science. And after that, I went to IT and started working there, and after, I think, more than 10 years, already working as a portfolio manager in a large Swiss bank, I realized that I do understand when we change processes, when we change team composition, when we change even like department composition, I do understand and I do care what is happening in people's brains, what happening in people's bodies. And it starts being clear for me that I'm trying to understand this on very low level. How specific amino acids are running inside the body? How specific areas of the brain are working, like working better, working worse, working more active in that case? I'm doing this for about sort of 10 years now, like this type of thinking. But only 2 or 3 years ago, I just realized that there is a name for it. And it is called neuroleadership. Neuroleadership is applied neuroscience to the processes that we have and to the processes that might help us to be better leaders, help us to create better work environments and so on. I'm not following neuroleadership as neuroleadership institute. I finished that, but I studied there, but it's not like 100%, just recalling what I found there. But the general application is very close to that. Who read this book? Yeah, I heard about that already. First fifteen. By the way, it's a diary. It's a diary of the submarine captain, and this is absolutely brilliant example of how he was able to transform his thoughts about leaders and his ability to transform people from give me orders to we are able to make decisions ourselves. But initially it came not like an advantage. Initially he was in quite a difficult position. By the way, I met him personally. And he's fantastic. So now he's a world-known consultant and something like really very well-known, one of the stars of Agile community and so on. He gave a keynote on Agile 2017. And I've met him, and he's like us. He's like us, he's absolutely normal, he's smiling, he's not pretending that he knows everything. He's that type of powerful, powerless leader that I just find I would like to be close to, that I would like to be like him, and so on. And he started when he was assigned to be a captain of a nuclear submarine. And a nuclear submarine, to be a captain, you should know every tiny detail, because the initial type of leadership was that captain give orders and everyone says, yes sir, yes sir, yes sir, and does exactly what is said by the captain. So the survival depends on how well captain knows technical details of the submarine. And he spent a year learning the exact submarine he's going to be captain. But then, about a month before he started, he got a call from his boss, who said, that's okay, you're going to be a captain, but it will be another submarine, another class of submarine, much more modern. And, by the way, it has the most awful team ever. They are not like understanding orders, they're making mistakes, we don't know why they survived yet, and people don't want to be there. So when they have a contract, if the contract is finished, they leave. So the main like metric there is if people want to stay on the boat and so on. And so, on a fleet, you can't say no to your boss. It's still that type of management. He said, okay, but he said that I'm in death march situation. I can't really work with the old type of leadership there. I don't have time to learn that submarine. And he said, I will do whatever I want with these people, change style of leadership, to be able to survive. So he started to create different style of leadership, not being the king of the uphill that I'm giving orders, but starting training people and using their knowledge of submarine, of technical things, their ability to see what details they have. And this, by the way, this picture is from servant leadership book, it's description of the servant leadership. When I'm not the only leader and others are followers, but when I encourage others to be leaders as well, at least leaders at their own level, when people are able to make decisions about their area of responsibility, to see, to understand what is happening, and to report that, to tell, and then make decisions. And that was very funny moment, for us funny, I think they were scared to death. When they tried to make an exercise, a normal exercise, when nuclear power is turned off, so something happened, and the submarine uses electricity engine. And he tried to make its exercise even more real, and tried to use as much electricity as he can to show that there is no power in submarine at all, and examine how people will work there. And he's ordered, like, make second speed of this electrical power. And everyone said, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir, and nothing happened. And he said, what's happening? Sorry, sir, there is no second speed on this boat. There is only one speed engine at all. And so he was scared and realized that with this, so nobody told him that it's not possible to do. So they said, yes, yes, yes. And if he didn't observe that nothing happened, so it might be a tragedy here. So his goal was that people should make decisions themselves and be able to understand what the situation is. And he started initially with tell me what to do. Then he trained them to show what they see, then what they think, then what they would like to, then what they intend to do, and then do it themselves and only report what was done. So he transformed the whole understanding, the whole mindset of himself and of the people. And in 1 year's time, they became the best crew of the submarine of the American fleet at all. And that was because People started thinking, and people start making a responsibility for their decisions and for their own lives. And more, even more, there were 14 officers on the submarine, and 10 of them later became captains as well. So this percentage is enormous. So he made conclusion from that. So to create leaders, you need to give power to people. But that's all right for him, because he was a captain of the submarine. He had absolute power on the submarine initially. He had something that he can transform to the people. And so this is the thing that he created. And in fact, what we have in our agile teams, when we have a leader of a team, of a company, or something like that, but inside we also need leaders. Why? Why in agile we need this structure as well? Because of the environment. If we were in absolutely stable environment, it was okay if a boss gives you an order and you have the stable environment, you do what he told, nothing changed, perfect, it's called conveyor. Possibly a little bit more complicated, you have a project, then you do this project and nothing changed, no extremely major change, and this is called construction. But we live in complex environment, we work with people, we work with open markets, where we have free will, where we have will when people buy our products or don't buy our products, when there is competition, when everything is changed and we can't understand cause and effect like 100% why this happened. It's complex environment and sometimes here. And there is no time to share decisions and make even small tiny decisions with the boss, with the large leader. We need to make this inside the team. And in that case, everyone in agile team should be a leader, at least at the level of yourself, of the level of the person to make responsibility for your own decisions, for your own activity, for your own dedication, and that is leadership as well. So this is called servant leader. There is a perfect book of Robert Greenleaf about how this was established initially. But then we have some misreading of what servant leader is. Is it a leader who serves the team, who agrees, who wants to serve the team, to be a servant of a team? Not really. Because it might come that we are not servant leader, but leader servant. Especially this is a problem for young girls who might be perfect Scrum Master, but the team treats them as a leader servant. Bring us coffee. There are a lot of stickers. So there is a board and so on, unfortunately. So in that case, we have something that powerless servant and his goal is to create powerless leaders inside the team. Something doesn't work here in that case. Where he can take this power from? We don't need servants for the team. We need leaders who can create other leaders. And we should find something inside us. What will help us to make it happen? And then we dig a little bit inside biology. We will dig in understanding what is leadership from the biological and from biological perspective, we are animals, yeah? From an animalistic perspective, how on unconscious level we understand who is leader, who is not a leader, and what makes this difference, where this difference comes from. Dichotomy is something that if we go right, we definitely do not go left. So it's something not, it can be this and can be this. No, it's all this or this. This is dichotomy. Can manager be a leader? Yeah. Is it possible that manager is not a leader, just a manager?
Yes.
It's not a dichotomy. So it's just things that can be combined or can be different. A servant leader and leader, is that a dichotomy? Servant leader is a leader. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Can we have leaders who is not a servant leader?
Yes.
Definitely, yeah. But there is one biological dichotomy. That is or one or another. This is dominant versus leader. Dominant can't be a leader. Leader can't be a dominant. And this is ethology. This is part of the biology that explores behavior of animals and people, as people are animals as well. And there are two very large branches. One is exploring how animals are behaving in a cage. And caged environment is that the environment is closed, it's not all absolutely open, and the food is coming from outside. So the food is given because of the behavior or because you are just there. It's like celery. And another one is a behavior in wild nature, where if you have food, you hunt it for it yourself. So it's your results, it's your responsibility. And if you do nothing, you will not get the food, you will not get results. Definitely, if you are in a team, it might be one person who brings more food and then shares with others. But still, it's not someone who gives you food and you just expect that it will fall from the heaven. It's something that you need to do yourself to really get results, and in animal terms, to get your food. And this is absolute dichotomy. It changes the mind completely. Dominant is a behavior in a cage, access to food. Leader is behaving in wild nature and hunting for food. There are animals who are able to create dominant behavior, and usually they do this in garbage bins. Somewhere where people create enormous amount of food they don't need to hunt for. They just like go and eat that. It's not really healthy, but they do that. And this caged environment is not something we are in physically. It's something that we put ourselves in mentally and start thinking about ourselves as people who are in a cage, who are in a strict environment, and if we behave well, or if we behave as was told by the boss, he will give us food. But at the same time, it might be that people are in absolute cage environment, but they think about themselves like, I'm not in. Nobody can control what's happening in my head. I'm responsible for what is happening. And in that case, this type of thinking is not about the cage. This is Viktor Frankl, famous for his open mind that was in the prison. So, but he was free in mental one. So it's not physical, it's mental stage. And what's happening with people when we start thinking that I'm in the cage of I'm in the cage of my work, I'm in the cage of my family, I'm in the cage of my country, I'm in the cage of anything we can think of, I'm in the cage of my team, anything. So there is no need for exploring because you are in the cage, so the space is limited. In that case, we have low dopamine. Dopamine is neurotransmitter in our brains. That is anticipation of pleasure, anticipation of result. And this anticipation of result gives us energy to make next step towards the result, and next step towards the result, and so on. So when we talk about energy in the people, we talk mainly about the dopamine system. It's internal drug, it's the same as amphetamine and cocaine. So it's practically the same. That's why they're working really in our brains, because they use the same receptors. But this is our internal driver to do anything. This is our desire. That is our wanting. And we never are ready to say that's enough. About the normal pleasure, we can say it's enough. can be enough serotonin, for example, in our brain, but it can't be enough of anticipation of something coming. So it's absolute drug in our. So no need exploring, no space for children, because it's again, it's an environment that is limited. So low testosterone, it's again energy for men and women. And there is no enemies outside, because the cage is not only protecting environment from you, but you are protected as well by the cage here. So low adrenaline, that is stress hormone, in that case you're less alert, you're more relaxed, and in that case you're constantly relaxed, you're not looking for something new and pleasurable, and you don't have like this male or active angry energy. And what happens with the body when we have all these reactions? People start feeling old. And this is really what's happening with the body when it's getting old. And it can happen 15, 20, 30 years, when normally this amount of hormones should be high. But now, because of thinking, because of the mental capacity, people start thinking that they are in the cage, I will sit on my job, I will get salary, I don't want anything else. I will do what I'm told to do, and this leads to people physically being older. And this leads that people start thinking that if I'm able, if I have energy, I'm able to get results. If I don't have energy when I'm feeling old, I have doubts. Am I able to get these results? Who will be my enemy? My enemy will be those around me who can eat my food that is given to me from the outside. And in that case, leader is someone who helps others to access external environment, to hunt for food, to get results, and happy about getting these results. And dominant in that case will be that type of, you might like bad bosses, who don't allow others to tell new ideas, don't allow others to be too clever, don't allow others to be too active, and say that don't like try to be more clever than I do. So this is the absolute difference. The one who is able to get results and have energy to get results is perceived as a leader, and who is aggressive to the inner circle and protects himself, his status, from those who are around him, from his own team, and is not able to hunt outside, will be a dominant and absolute dichotomy there. So he is dominant, like kicking everyone from the food. And what, for example, if there is a dominant environment, and there can be dominant teams and dominant companies as well. What if there is a leader, still natural leader, who is in that environment? How he will behave? Sorry?
Try to break out.
So sometimes he will try to run away of this environment. Some try to break out this environment. And depending on his personal power, he might want to transform a team. He might want to leave this transformation for himself only, and it's still leadership behavior because he's able to get results. Or if the leader has internal power, this will be the one who will start agile transformation. So these are the people who will understand that this is not an environment that is healthy for people. This is not an environment where we'll be able to get results, where we will stay above the competition. This is the person who will start, challenge the status quo and start agile transformation. This is all of us. This nice mouse. What triggers people to become dominant, to think they are in the cage? So initially we are all born as leaders, but then something happens. What might happen with the person to start thinking he is in the cage?
Society happens.
Yeah, something happens.
Comfort zone.
comfort zone, and I might add comfort zone, and he doesn't know that this comfort zone can be like larger, something like that, yeah?
He discovers some limitations.
Yeah, he discovers some limitations that starts being stronger than he perceives himself, yeah.
Experience,
and it might be experience that he tried something and failed and was not able to recover from that, or experience that he doesn't see anything around him that will show him different example. So everyone around are dominance, it's dominant environment, he sees this in school, he saw this in army, he has this in his family, he doesn't know that there can be a different type of thinking, different type of behavior. So these are the most important or the most common ones. Habit is that doesn't know and it's always I behave like that. Burnout, and this is one of the reasons why I'm working as a coach with about burnout with teams, companies and people. Because when people lose their energy, and burnout is losing energy without natural ability to restore it. So when people lose their energy, they start being afraid of large tasks, of challenges, of change, everything. And if they're not able to recover from burnout, it might happen that they become dominant. No access to result. If I'm doing something and I'm not able to understand what I've done, I don't have access to my result. That means that my result will be this food that comes from somewhere. Only salary, no results that my brain will understand as a result for me as a leader. Bureaucracy as one of the things that when you can't get results, when you have only process of the process of the process of the process, yeah, and no results as well. Or some major failure. It can be divorce, it can be project failure, it can something bad happen with the help, something happens, and the person is not able to recover. In that case, we have. So this problem with dominance is not real problem with that they are bad people. They might be good people with low amount of energy. So are you able to be a leader or not? Depends on how much internal energy you have. And this is physical and mental energy, and it's combined as we, this all influences each other. So this is a circle. And let's explore components of a leader, how we can measure and how we can understand what is inside our head. So we can try to think, are we leaders? Or is our team consisting of leaders or not? First is rank potential. Rank potential is the dopamine system, that anticipation. What do you think you are capable of? Not what you currently are capable of. Not what is your current social status. Not even what is your current level of energy. But what you think about yourself, what you dream about yourself. If you are reading books about Elon Musk or Richard Branson, for example, or people who changed the world completely and are absolutely dreaming, I would like to be the same, I would like to do the same thing, I would like to have the same results. It means that you have the rank potential of the people you who are your role model. So it's your thinking, your caliber, what you think the size of the result you would like to have. You can, people can be a truck driver, so currently socially, so his social position is just a truck driver. And he thinks about himself as a truck driver. It means that current social status, amount of energy, and his rank potential are sort of identical. But there can be a person who currently is still driving the truck, but he thinks about, when I drive the truck with these goods from this city, the marginal income is like that, from that city it's closer, fuel is cheaper, and so on. So he thinks about himself as an owner of a truck, as an independent person. And in this case, his amount of current social position is like that, and rank potential is higher. He can still drive the truck, but think about himself as, there is Petya, he's a great guy, I would hire him. There is Vasya. He's drinking, he's lying, he's not that good driver. I would not hire him if I'm owner of several trucks and they will work for me. Their rank potential is of a person who owns the company with several employees and so on. Or I can still be a truck driver and think about these driverless trucks and this program that might transform the whole industry. And in that case, he will not think about that, oh, there will be truckless industry, I will lose my job, it's all awful, they don't think about us, they don't care about us, and so on, I want to protect my salary and I will resist any changes. No, he will think, oh, that's great, that's an interesting program, I would like, it doesn't mean that he will do some active steps, but I would like to be involved in this one. I would like to read more, and if I have a chance, I would contribute to this program as much as I can. That means that current level of energy and social status is like that, the same as all previous guys. By his rank potential is he's thinking about changing the world or participating in changing the world. So it's what you think about yourself. And rank potential is, again, dopamine system, and the level of testosterone that you have. Dopamine, about rank potential, we are not all equal. We are not all born equal. And there can be, dopamine is neurotransmitter, as we have neural cells. That's the body of the neural cell. This is how we understand signal. And then it goes here, and it's called axon, and then the signal is transformed there. And inside here, it's electricity that goes inside the cell, but cells are never closely connected. They always have synaptic gap. So thank you so much. It's interesting what type of word I will forget today. So one cell, understanding how much it's... how much electricity it has, it releases dopamine. And another cell has receptors to dopamine. And then dopamine goes to these receptors. And depending on how much receptors you have and how much dopamine is here, then another neuron or says like, whew, there is a lot of energy, or whew, there is some energy, or whew, there is no energy. So it's quite simple. But we have in our brain that there are 86 billion neurons, quite a lot, and only 7,000 of them in deep inside our brain are those who produce dopamine. So, and it's very, very vulnerable part of the brain, as any things that kill dopamine system, any addictions, drugs, games, extensive social networks, excessive information gathering, something like that, it kills these neurons or make them less active and remove amount of receptors. And there are people who are born with more active dopamine cells. It can be like 10,000 dopamine receptors per cell, or it can be 40,000 dopamine receptors per cell. And those who have initial 40,000 dopamine receptors, their main driver is, it's interesting. I would like to go there, and I'm not scared. Additionally, because when dopamine is released, it's additionally one more chemical is released that goes into your body and partially blocks stress hormones. When you are interested, you are not scared. When you are scared, you are not interested. So those with high rank potential are people who have very high tolerance to change, very high tolerance to unknown, and it's interesting, and it's new, and it's engaging is their main driver. Not it's difficult, it's scary, I don't want to go there, I want to stay on the status quo, and so on.
What about bungee jumping?
Bungee jumping is adrenaline, and it's quite good as well. It's a slightly different, and it's slightly different one because
scared,
it?
So we're calibrating our nervous system with base jumping. Because if we are in sort of stable environment, every problem, so every quarrel with a colleague, any small problem, our brain understands that there is high in adrenaline, so it's a problem, it's a problem, it's a problem. And then we go to base jumping, and there is adrenaline, wow! And our brain remembers, my God, this is what means I'm scared. And this problem with a colleague, this problem at work, this is practically nothing. Yeah, and it's really healthy, and doctors really recommend when your nervous system starts being too weak and starts understanding that every small piece is a huge problem for you, go to base jumping. Yeah, or something like that, that increases adrenaline. It's a different system, it's not like that. Yeah. And about testosterone, it's like well known. Men have 100 times more testosterone than women, but for women, even it's a small amount. It can be women with high testosterone and low testosterone as well. And by the way, testosterone is quite vulnerable as well. So 4 hours sleep instead of 8 hours sleep, and you have half of the testosterone, and your brain starts thinking, oh, I will change the world, but not today. And it's physical. So you physically can't want. So when you have low dopamine and low testosterone, there is no desire, no wanting, no brain power to do these things. The second one that is important for the leader is primativity. It's mainly the word is prime. What is primal? If my goals are more, I understand my goals and they are more important for me than goals of the society, than goals of the company, the goals of the team. I understand my own goals. This will be a high primativity. If I don't understand my goals and go with something that society, family, company, anything like that, television tells me to do, this is low primativity. Usually, so when it's 100% of primativity, this is sociopathy. When people don't understand that it's not allowed to kill other people, something like that. So serial killers have primativity, their goals, what they want to do in extremely high conditions. It's not really a good thing to have a very high primativity. It's good to have it normal so we can live in the society, and good to be a little bit high above this line to really understand and be able to pursue your own goals. Because it's interesting. Because it's high rank potential. And the third one is vitality. Amount of energy that you have today that you can use for your everyday activities, that you can use to work with your team, to help the team, to protect the team, or to understand what you can do to make a team lives better. And this is the model that I will share with you now. I was a guinea pig there, all laboratory rat. It was created by two psychologists. One was psychiatrist and another was psychologist and sociologist. In that case, with this model, we can compare people. Because if you think about yourself, you can have 50% of energy or 100% of energy inside yourself. But if I compare it with you, is my 50% of energy, it may be for you is something like 30 and you have internal energy much higher than I do. Or it can be that your 100% of energy for me is something like 70%. And this is rank potential, how large your battery is. So in that case, we think this model is about the whole society, where we can think about the people who are like, what's the difference between people with 50% of energy with those with 60 and so on. And I participated in the tests of this model. We did it for 1.5 years. We were in a group and shared what mental abilities, what psychological reactions we have, depending on what type of energy we had. And I will share with you this model. And first, inside you can write this down. or just think about your team, in case Vasya, Petya, Kolya. So people with whom you're communicating most of your time, or exactly the team that you're working with, not including you. And I will share the model, and when you think, it's Vasya, it's Petya, it's Kolya, think about what's the level of your team. We will need sort of an average. It starts from 0 to 100, and on the 0, it's nothing. It's coma. Nothing is happening. So your brain is working, but nothing else. Because on 5%, people start swallowing and digestion starts. Very biological level. Then on 10%, you're able to get dressed and move inside the house. And we can think about this model as restoring from really deep illness. And this is really as when we don't have energy and then we get some energy and able to use that. On 15%, now you're able to choose clothes, prepare food, and do some easy activities about 15 minutes. You might know these enchanted forest or other drawings where there is pre-drawn pictures and you just color them. Colored pictures for adults, these type of things. This is type of activity that is absolutely perfect for this type of amount of energy. So you draw them and you calm down, it's easy, and your brain relaxes and adds some energy. So this is the way how you increase your energy a little bit. Not trying to conquer the world when you're just able to get out of bed, but do something that is very close to your real abilities. 25%, this amount of energy is enough to go to work. But it's not mental work yet. It's manual labor. It's quite short, and unfortunately, this amount of brain is not enough yet to understand that I should start work and finish the work. So it should be some external signal, some ring that we started work, we ended work, and so on. And sorry for my Russian, копать от забора до обеда. This is the way how people behave in that case. So, and if there are known rules, these people will be fine. If there are no known rules, these people will be absolutely anxious and not able to work. This is conveyor. This is conveyor, and this was established about 1,700 years where after the plague, where people were not able to, so didn't have a real health to work with the manufacturing. When manufacturing starts being the key of the productivity, not the people. So this was the amount of energy people had, practically all people had at that moment. 30%. At that moment, your brain is able to select activity himself, can get energy from external feedback. So when you say, it's good, you're great, oh yes, it's good, I'm great. You're bad, the work is bad. So okay, so understanding and changing behavior because of the external feedback. Person is not able to understand that he did, so there is no internal feedback. So it must be only external. But person starts understanding, previously, no way. And can't play. This is especially important for trainers and for agile coaches, scrum masters who want to introduce something in the team using Lego play, all these marshmallow challenges and so on, expecting that we will draw, build, or something like that at the training, and then people will be able to take this and use this at work. No. They will not. It's not enough brain to do that. At that moment, only I raise the hand, another person raises the hand, down, hand down, hand down. So only repetition, only what your inner crocodile can do. 35%. Now people start understanding what time is, so if there is, am I in time or not, panic if anything changes, but confident in the known environment. It's 35%. Would you be happy to work with this person in your agile team?
No.
For some teams, yes. For some teams, no. If we think about Scrum team, Yeah. For Scrum teams, we need so people be able to tolerate change and even embrace change, even propose something. Think about how they will be doing some problem for the customers. So it's not enough. And why I'm asking it here? Because we made a research about what is average amount of energy in office workers. Office workers, not manual labor. 33%. So it's something between this, when people only don't understand what they've done, they only wait for external feedback and only can repeat what someone else did, or between ability to schedule but still panic in the known environment. This is what we see in the streets. This is what we see in the public transport. This is what is around us. And this is not enough. When we just take people from the streets, it's not enough. 40%. There is an ability to manage, so people understand boundaries between myself and other person, and I'm able to manage and avoid some conflicts, not participate in all conflicts, only in some conflicts. Ability to change, so people understand that change is possible, possibly not for myself, but by someone else, better for by the team, but it's not a panic activity here. Oh, and willpower. So people have willpower only on 40%. Before, understanding that I do something now, that it will be better tomorrow, no way, it's not present in the head at all. 45%. So remember primitivity? 45% of energy gives you ability to understand your own goals, and these goals start to be more important. So it's starts being very difficult to manipulate these people, because we will need them to adjust what we like want them to do with what they really want to do. But here we start moving towards positive environment. So I do something today, it will be better tomorrow, and it's a motivator. Ability to handle changes, and this is the minimum amount of energy that we would like in Scrum teams. What is the difference about energy with Kanban teams? If this is in the Scrum team, minimum 45, what is the minimal amount for Kanban teams? You think it's higher? You think it's lower? You're all right. Because Kanban can be applied to any amount of energy. It depends what type of Kanban system you will have. The lower the energy, the more proto Kanban you will have. The high amount of energy, the more advanced Kanban system you will have. But initially, it can be applied to anywhere. Scrum has more limitations as it has some defined requirements for the team. 50-55%. This is amount of energy when we are identified as a leaders. Because when we are about 5-10% over the general environment, over our team, we are considered as beautiful, sexy, wise, worth listening, worth hearing, and that ideas are really something that we would consider. So this is a key for attractiveness, and this is the key for leadership. As we would like to be like you, we would like to follow you, because if you go somewhere where it's interesting to you, you will find somewhere where it will be interesting for us as well. 60% is a breakthrough, as well as the same as it was on 45. At that moment, people start understanding that despite they have their own mental models that they think are perfect, it might be in reality that different company and other people and other processes are good enough for other people, and they don't need to be modified. So if Scrum Master or Agile Coach are below 60%, in that case it will be, I love Scrum, I have Scrum in my head, everyone should go Scrum. I like safe, I love less, I love any of other 14 scaling frameworks, and we apply Spotify, not thinking about will it really fit the company, or I just love the model. So ability to change and understand what need to be modified and what need to be not modified in the company, people, and myself is again matter of energy here. 65-75. This is the amount of energy when inside your head, different ideas from different examples, from different experiences, they just click together. Two or more neurons then just connect together and you have new ideas, and amount of energy is that high that is practically impossible not to start your own projects. You might still work in the company, but you will have your own pet project, or you will start something else. And this is thought leadership, so something new that nobody created before. And it's so interesting and attractive that there are people who are interested in that and would like to follow. This is entrepreneurship. And this is the amount of energy that we would like from
CEOs,
definitely, yeah.
Agile coaches.
So for agile coaches, minimum is 60. We would like definitely to be like that and create something ourselves, as all high names from agile environment is this amount, because that is why we know them. Yeah. Yeah, it's product owner, definitely. So in that case, amount of energy for the product owner is 65-75. For agile coach, minimum 60. For scrum master, minimum 50. For agile team, minimum 45%. And when we're thinking about, are we able to go to the next level? Is our team able to do what we expect from that? We not only need to think about skills, we also need to think, do they have enough energy to do that? And on 80 or 100 level, this is world-known people, so their ideas really change the world. And people who are living now and changing the world, they are considered something like 80. Because 100, it's immortality in history. Something that people will remember them for 20 or 200 years, 2,000 years, and so on. Those who really change the world and it lasts. So for now, I would consider for us to think about rank potential about 80. For all of us, why?
Still living,
and why not less?
He wants to change the world.
Yeah, because conferences like that attract only people who want to change the world, to know better about how this is doing, to look at the role models of people who already tried this. And so we really don't have these, we're not that afraid of change. We love change and so on. And we might not understand that other people don't like that change so much. And by the way, there is a very nice app that is for iPhone and Android that is able to measure your own energy. So not about the team, but about your own energy. So just finger and will tell you like you have 25% of energy today. I might consider another training schedule. No, and so on. How much energy your team has? If you were able, well, I was discussing two things, so it looks like my team, it looks like my people. Throw in me, what amount of energy your team has? 40, 45?
30, 40.
30, 40, uh-huh.
Not enough.
5,000. Not enough? 5,000, okay. Yeah? The training, we're doing this more precise, so why I'm asking about not you? So we're discussing leaders, we're discussing you. Why I'm asking about the team? Because we have things that is called energy contagion. Mirror neurons that in our head, on unconscious level, we can't control this. We make amount of energy more or less identical. So when very energetic leader goes in the team that is 20-25%, starting from 15 minutes, and you can't stop that, it's the same mechanism as empathy, understanding face выражение, understand face expression, and thinking how a person is behaving and so on, the same is with energy. So, and we understand another's amount of energy, and amount of energy starts to be more equal. In that case, quite soon, if you're constantly communicating with the people with certain amount of energy, quite soon you will be this for the same amount of energy. And there might be a problem that you might have environment 35-40. It's 35-40-45, that is average for the company, IT companies. 33 as a normal environment, that is outside. And you as a leader, to be perceived as a team leader, need at least 50-55, or 60, or 75 if you want to create new ideas. And this energy gap is something that we need to maintain, and we need special things that will raise our energy above the environment and make it stable enough so the team, the environment, problems, and so on will not reduce it. Because if you're 50, you're considered by others as a leader. 45, you're considered as a nice person, possibly with some ideas, but not worth following. You stop being a leader. You move below at about 30, 25, and this is a level when people start being dominant. Because it's not enough energy to hunter in the outer world, it's not enough energy to understand what results I'm going to have, not enough energy to want something and start protecting your own small environment. It's the matter of energy. And this one is also connected with the brain that we have. Rank potential is reptilian brain, that is our inner crocodile. Primitivity is our limbic brain, or our inner kitten. And vitality is amount of energy that we have in our prefrontal cortex, or our human brain. And let's do an exercise. If we think there is a person with rank potential 100, primitivity 100, vitality 100. Who's that? Can be name or position or anything. Superman. What should be modified to this person to be a Superman? Yeah, so it should be primitivity should be slightly lower, because this Superman will kill everyone around him to pursue his goals.
So it's Godzilla, right?
Yes, this is Godzilla. Exactly. This is mafia boss. These are people who just don't think about other people at all. But their level of desires and their level of energy allow to change the world, usually not for good.
Hitler.
Yeah, Hitler. Yeah. Who's that? Rank potential very high, primitivity normal, just a normal person, vitality quite high. Bill Gates can be all these, Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, Richard Branson, Elon Musk, all these type of guys, this is that one. This is the person who might start a clever company with some innovative ideas. And so not inherit that. This is what we would like to expect from our CEOs, and what we would like to expect from our product owners, because we expect them to change the world as well. Who's that?
Me.
Drug driver? Drug driver, it's 50. It's truck driver who is thinking about starting his own company and hire several people, yes. And not only thinking, but he's already doing that. So he's already owner of several trucks.
I would say this is the average person in this conference.
I would not agree, because this rank potential is not enough to want to go to this conference. So I really expect everyone here to have at least 80. Here, I more or less agree that so after 2 days of conference, or 2 days of training and 2 days of conference, you might be somewhere at that level. And also, I might think that your primitivity is slightly higher, as there is something interesting, that something that you will take for yourself And you have your own ambitions and your own goals that are possibly more important than someone that just company told you to do. So if you are sent by the company, so just go there, you didn't want. It might be about somewhere here. If you wanted to go yourself, I think that it's slightly higher. But who's that?
Bookkeeper.
Bookkeeper, office worker. Guys, it's a happy person.
Happy person?
Yes. He wants what he has. And he has what he wants. He is absolutely normal in this society. He understands his own desires and understands there are others that want something from him. Absolutely happy person. When you have vitality equal rank potential, it's like you fulfill your potential. And it's something that biologically it's urged to do that. But what if we have these people in the team, what will be the problem?
Everything is nice,
we are in the comfort zone. It's very difficult to challenge them. To challenge them, rank potential should be somewhere like 60. 5-10% of rank potential higher than energy. And these will be ideal workers. They are jumping. They want, they see the result quite not far away. So that they will pursue their rank potential. They will get what will make them happy. It's a dopamine again. So I'm not full of already achieved goals, but I want more, and it's not far, and I will try a little bit more perfect work.
Wanda, do you want to say that the happy person don't have wishes?
It has
or dreams?
No, it definitely has dreams, but in the same time, he has abilities to pursue them. It's not something that I will be able to do that when I after vacation. Oh, I will do this. First, I will do all my urgent job, and then I will pursue my goals. Okay. This is what I'm currently able to go towards. Well, that.
It's like after you succeed.
And after succeeded, and this is the key that you will succeed. You have energy for that. Yeah, it can be vitality here and rank potential here. It will be the same. It will be different levels of desire. Who's that? Not tired, vitality is higher.
Somebody who has a lot of energy but doesn't know what to do with it.
Yes, someone who has a lot of energy and doesn't know what to do with that. By the way, this is not, I see you. By the way, it's not possible. So the rank potential limits amount of vitality. This is usually when rank potential is lowered artificially. So people are not allowed to desire, don't allow to want something. Or it might be like yoga teachers, sportsmen who have very good physical abilities.
And these also are kids?
Possibly. But kids are about 11 years old, they have rank potential going
small
up to... small kids, yes. So their rank potential is not yet developed.
Yes.
Yeah, but a lot of energy. From 11 years old, they should be. It will be maximum rank potential,
yeah,
and then.
Yeah, five, so it's.
And it's very difficult to manipulate, because what you want not match what they want. Who's that? Definitely. It's a burnout situation. So, and in that case, the worst thing about burnout, and that is why I'm working with it so closely, is when you have this amount of energy, amount of vitality will lower, will you understand your goals or not? So if you have low energy, most probably you will follow some others' desires, some others' wishes, what others want you to do, not understanding what you really want. And rank potential will be. I'm a coach for burnout, and people come to me, Anya, I previously wanted a lot. Now I don't want anything. I want to want again. So I remember that I had rank potential. There is still memory there. But really, I can't want. So vitality amount of energy that you currently have will limit ability of your rank potential. That is why burnout is so dangerous. So we have this amount of energy that identifies Are you a leader or not? Is your team able to have leaders at least at the level of individual person? And it's called vitality quotient. And now it's identified as a base of everything. It doesn't matter what skills you have. It doesn't matter what position you have. If you don't have energy to do that, you have nothing. So first think about this. Even emotional intellect, it's again something that should be based on energy. If you don't have energy, guys, on 30, there is no emotional intellect at all. Not yet emotional intellect. So, and what I'm doing with all these things, so my main thing that I'm trying to do with the teams and people, there is a framework, how we can change external environment, internal environment, the motivation or system of people, and how different they are, to increase, to fill this gap in energy, to be able to make your team leaders of the team level, and yourself leaders of above team level if you need that. And the most interesting about that, that if you are in the, like a normal company, your career will mainly depend on your skills and your relationships with your boss. If your boss goes up, he takes the whole team up. If you quarrel with your boss, you will need to start practically again creating relationships with your own boss. This is not true for agile leadership, on the true biological leadership. Because you are building your anthill of energy, how much people do you influence? How many people want to follow you? How many people find your ideas interesting? And this is perceived, again, mirror neurons, and perceived on unconscious level. Everyone feels, what level do you have? And this starts from 3 years old. Your child already knows who is the main person in the family.
Yes.
So you can't lose that. So building this anthill of yourself. And it depends on only one thing, that there is no spoon, there is no cage. That's it. Thank you.